right. Well, welcome, everybody. Good evening. I'm Matt Menashis. I'm the NGS Executive Director, and welcome to tonight's webinar, Behind the Scenes with Ancestry Story Producers Nicka Sewell-Smith and Lisa Elzey. Tonight's webinar is being recorded and will be available on the NGS YouTube channel within the next week to 10 days. So please take a look for it there. Towards the end of tonight's presentation, we will have time for Q&A. So please feel free to drop your questions into the chat or use the raise your hand function with the Zoom controls, and we'll be able to call on you to unmute yourself and put yourself on camera, and you will be able to talk and ask questions directly to Nicka and Lisa. So with that, let me introduce Nicka Sewell-Smith and Lisa Elzey, story producers at Ancestry, and I'll let them give their bios and let them get started for the evening. Welcome, Lisa. Welcome, Nicka.
Thank you. We are so excited to be here. This is fantastic. This is my first time, I think, speaking at NGS. So thank you all for being here. It's so exciting. I know Nika's been here many times, but I'm really excited to talk to you guys today. I'm Lisa Elzey. I'm a senior story producer at Ancestry. I've been with Ancestry almost 12 years now, and I'm a genealogist as well. A story producer is just a fancy title for I find stories in family trees that we can share with media, that we can share on our television programming, that we can help share with customers, different things like that to help inspire people to want to dive into their family tree and find stories in their own tree. So I love what I do. I'm blessed with what I do. And I'm excited to talk to you today.
That was a great description of our title, Lisa. and what we actually do, because when people hear it and they're not in the production world, they wonder what a story producer is. And despite all the wonderful programs that we have regarding genealogy, as effortless and seamless and as easy as it all looks, those of you who are here realize that sometimes it's easy, but sometimes it's not so easy. And there are people behind all of your favorite shows that are scouting and looking for incredible things to share. And that's what our team gets to do each and every day. But at the very core of who we are family historians and people who care a lot about family and memories and preserving them and getting, helping other people connect in the ways that we all connect. You know, we all remember the first time we ever saw the name of someone we knew or that we had heard about in a record. And the fact that that one moment that we had is what's carried us through our entire journeys as family historians. And so, you know, when we get together and meet, we don't get together as senior story producers. We get together as family historians and people who are very passionate about what we do. I just kind of moonlight in this space. I'm kidding. I'm the resident cheerleader and genealogy evangelist. That's what I do. Right. I'm the genealogy evangelist is what we do. You definitely make sure you all use the chat. This is not a one-sided conversation. We want to hear from you all. We want to know, you know, your reactions. Maybe there's something that we say that resonates with you or that maybe you haven't thought about or considered. This is an active space. So, you know, as I say, holler back at us. And make sure that we can see that you're here and that you're listening and that you're gleaning a lot because we have a lot to share.
Awesome. So I think we're going to go ahead and share that deck on screen with you guys.
Yep.
And then we'll get started.
All right. There we go. Got to make sure I choose the right monitor. Okay. There we go. Perfect. All Amazing. Right. Everyone is here. We are all here and accounted for. Welcome to Behind the Scenes with Ancestry Story Producers. We're going to give you just a brief description of what we're going to be talking about tonight. And then I'm going to toss it over to Lisa Elzey to begin our session. Tonight, we're going to give you a sneak peek into how our team, the senior story producers at Ancestry, We start with an idea and turn it into a moving and memorable story, including tips for records, research, and crafting the perfect narrative to share your family history. And here's the thing, you don't have to be on a major network. You don't have to, me and Lisa have done everything from working with people who are descendants of people who were the greatest of all time to doing design shows where we work on the family history of the guests. We've done all that kind of stuff, but everything we do in those shows and the stuff that we work on, it has applicable tips and tricks that connect back to how you can share your family history with your family who might, they may not ever be on television for the family history. It doesn't matter. As long as you're passing the stories down, that's what we care about the most. So Lisa, I'll go ahead and toss it over to you.
So we have three sections of our presentation tonight. It's going to be the before. We're talking about the before we do the production and the during and the after. And we're taking two stories that we did with NBC Sports. Nicka and I both did the research on these stories, and then we both presented them to the athletes. These are collegiate athletes. We'll talk about that in a bit. But we wanted to kind of, like Nicka said, give you an idea that what we do as our job is something that can be applied as well to anybody's family tree to help find stories. So it's kind of a case study, but also some really great tips and tricks. All right, so the before, the great start. You always have to start well, right? We want to have a good start. So the way we always want to start is starting with what you know. That's what everybody here hopefully knows, that is how you start with a family tree. You always start with what you know, any family history journey, talking to those and those living ancestors that you have, grandparents, aunts, uncles, your parents, getting down the family story, getting down what they know. And next, you need to include every detail. Now, you might not think that when you're collecting those stories that the details matter. I promise you they do. Sometime you'll come back and say, I remember Aunt Margaret said something about such and such. And sure enough, you'll have it in the stuff that you've recorded. And that might give you a clue on a future puzzle that you don't know is coming. So make sure you collect all the details. And lastly, again, we said talk to family members to help fill in those blanks. So start with what you know as yourself, what you've been told or what you've heard, and then go expand out into that family and see what you can find out. So with our great start with the NBC Sports, we did the same exact idea. So we want to start with what we knew. So the athletes that were with us in this production, they both sent in family history forms. And this over here, you can see on the slide, is one of the family history form that we send out to production partners, and they fill out the form. So what's really incredible, these are young men in their 20s in college. They're both collegiate athletes, football players specifically. And they filled out their forms amazingly, which made it easier for us to get back in time more quickly. So they asked around. I'm sure they asked their parents or grandparents or, like, just like I said, family members, and helped them fill out that form. But they really put all of the information they had into that form, which helped us be able to find stories more quickly. They included every detail. They had things they'd heard over the years. They even put in the little margins. They were writing, you know, I heard this, and it says siblings on the form, and they filled out every sibling that was part of that family. And they even gave context to some of the things that they wrote down. And then it gave context to our findings because we said, oh, that's right. They wrote this in the margin, and it helped us understand where they were coming from. And they asked the elders in their family. They specifically said, I talked to my grandmother or talked to my aunt, and they helped me figure this out. So we love that it became a multi-generational project for them to find out the information.
All right. And continuing with the before, we have to talk about the research. That's why you all are here, right? You think we've got a magic button that releases all the records. It's like Willy Wonka of genealogy comes out and all the things get produced. No, we research just like you all. So don't feel, again, like we have this, again, we don't have the river of chocolate. I think me and Lisa probably would like to have a river of chocolate.
Yes, please.
Right, that you could just grab documents out of. I personally would like that myself. But no, we research just like you all. And what does that mean? You need to start with what you know, right? And familiar websites like Ancestry, those are things that you're going to go to first, regardless of who you're researching. You're also going to make sure you patronize things like libraries, your traditional sources, things that you know that you have success with. I can guarantee you the majority of the folks who are here tonight are going to say, well, yeah, obviously that's like the U.S. Census, it's birth, marriage, and death records, it's things like that. Those are your go-tos. Those are your plays that you are always going to lean into. And then at the same time, while we have those things that are tried and true, we also have to be open to new stuff. And sometimes folks neglect search engines altogether or just thinking like, hey, that's not a resource I can use. But we all know if you've been in this for more than 20 years, people have been blogging. They have had those old listservs. You've got email lists. You've got all kinds of stuff that's online. People putting up personal, you know, family websites, all sorts of stuff. Don't neglect that. The other thing is you also can seek out experienced researchers and family historians. So let's say it's a new area for you. There's certain things that I lean on Lisa for, like she, just like she does with me. If Arkansas or Mississippi and Louisiana comes up, she's like, girl, I don't know. Help me. I'm not sure. And if I'm dealing with New York, or if I'm dealing with a particular type of record that I'm not totally familiar with, then I do the same thing with Lisa. Also, you also want to push through frustration, because the other part about it is that sometimes you don't get the answer immediately. And we're going to talk about this a little bit more later. Hi, it's a Tuesday night at my house. Either way, sometimes you're going to have to dig deep, and you're not going to get the answer you want or the story that you think you're going to get on the surface. You got to go a little bit further than what the document is saying on its face. And the other part is sometimes when you wait just a little while, you let things bake for a little bit, you actually discover things that are a better story to tell than the original thing that you thought you were. So keep a pen in that. All right, now, when it comes to this specific set of stories, we are both very experienced in researching African-American families. In fact, if you've ever seen our incredible film that we both got to work on, A Dream Delivered, The Lost Letters of Hawkins Wilson, you will see me on camera. And yes, I did help with the research, but that is really the heart and soul of Lisa Elzey. I don't even know your middle name. I was gonna call you Lisa Nicole Elzey, but that's probably not your middle name. But that was Lisa. That was her chasing that. That was her baby. I helped. I was the midwife, right? Lisa carried the baby, but I was the midwife. I delivered the baby. And it was both a team effort. And so that's the thing. Even if you're not well-versed in African-American research, there are a ton of resources available online on Ancestry and other places so that you can become well-versed so you know how to dig into the stories. The other thing is, for one of the stories, it was my jam. I got to do what I love to do in Louisiana. And because I specialized there, it was just a dream to be able to do that. The other thing is, the name of the movie is A Dream Delivered, The Lost Letters of Hawkins Wilson. You can watch it on YouTube, but you better make sure you do it soon. It's an incredible piece. It details the journey of a mother and a daughter and them connecting with their ancestor who wrote an incredible letter to the Freedmen's Bureau to be reconnected with his family. Now, going back to things, in terms of using new plays, being open to new collections, it's some that included photos and journals that were new to us, you've got to constantly keep yourself in a place where you are willing to receive and work in stuff that you're just not used to, or things that you're like, wow, that's there, I didn't realize that was there. The other thing is, on one project, the main story was found the day before we needed to present this, you know, here's what we found. So sometimes with all your best laid intentions, it's not going to come until the last minute. Sometimes it's like that, but you have to create space for that. And the other thing is, it can take time to find the story, right? So that's the thing. There are a ton of leaves on people's trees, and sometimes you just really kind of have to study who you're talking to know what's going to land appropriately. Thank you, Miss Pamela, for putting that in the chat. You put the name in there.
All right. So thank you for that. And Nicka delivered a beautiful baby. So well done with the film. She's amazing in the film. All right. Athlete one. So I had the luxury slash you know, I don't know if it's a luxury, but I got to film mine first. So what that meant was anything that we learned along the way, we could then hopefully apply to the next shoot, which is great because we want to get better and faster and all of that. And so mine was in Michigan. So it was a football player. Athlete one was a football player at Michigan State University. And we looked at his paternal line and mostly from Stark County, Ohio, some counties in Mississippi, and all of that. And his dad's side of the family was really the athletic side of the family. His father had played collegiate sports, his uncle had played collegiate sport. So there were a lot of research discoveries that included articles about their accomplishments in sport. There were yearbook photos, fantastic yearbook photos of like his dad dunking and being on the dunk squad in high school. That's what they called him. And the group of guys that loved to dunk. And so those were really great. And we also traced a surname. The athlete was really interested in finding out more of about his surname. We were able to trace that back to his fourth great grandfather. So that was really special and exciting because this was an African American athlete. And so we got back to his enslaved ancestor and found that surname, kind of that or origin of his surname. So that was an interesting story. The next part of it, we wanted to look at mom's side of the tree. And oh, sorry, there's the athlete. There's a legacy of sport. So you had that legacy of sport, multiple members playing there. Oh, they won a bunch of awards, including induction into the university itself's Athletic Hall of Fame. So when we talked to this athlete, he would mention how he would see, you know, oh yeah, there's my dad's plaque on the wall, and you know, every time I pass it, and there it is. And so I'm sure it was a point of pride, but also a point of, you know, pressure. So then the second side of his family, mom's side, she had ancestors from Wayne County, Michigan, Lee County, Mississippi, Hannibal County, Missouri. So kind of all in that same like strip of land area up and down north and south of the United States. And so with some research discoveries there, we discovered some photos of second great grandparents. So I don't know about you, but when I discover a photo of a second great grandparent, I am so excited because I don't have all of the photos of my own second great grandparents. So number one, for someone who is an African American, if they come from an enslaved background, having photos of further back generations is not a very common thing. And so finding those second great grandparents, third great grandparent photos, incredible discoveries. Newspaper article about the fourth great grandfather, again, fourth great grandfather in Northern California, which is really kind of fascinating. And then from that, we were able then to discover the name of the fifth great grandfather and a description of his character from a contemporary. Again, I would be thrilled to find out what people thought about any of my ancestors. And here we have someone who's that far back in his tree and written by a contemporary about that person and the kind of person that he was. Pretty fascinating. Here is part of that. So we talked about the fourth great grandfather going to California. We found some newspaper articles about him. And he was out there in the late 1800s, and he was a very well-known member of his community in California. And he performed many times at these kind of gatherings that the community had in the Woodland area. And they said his name is Frank Quarles. And they said at the bottom, Mr. Quarles has a fortune before him as a comedian, should he ever choose to adopt the stage as a profession. That's amazing just to have this little piece of information about his character, kind of who he is. You can kind of envision this guy that just is, you know, has amazing stage presence, and somebody's writing about how, yeah, if he ever wants to just do this, he could totally do it. The next piece of research that we found that was even more incredible was the fifth great grandfather, Dan Quarles. And Dan was enslaved by a man named John Quarles, and he was enslaved in Hannibal, Missouri. Dan was manumitted by his slave owner in 1855, and we found a copy of that manumission. So pretty incredible, not something common that you know, just casually find. But what this led to for me, as I'm, you know, finding this out, Hannibal, Missouri, it was you know, I was thinking, I put in here, it was reminiscent of some high school English classes, you know, like Hannibal. And also I'm a theater person, you know, so there's some memories here trying to like, where have I heard Hannibal, Missouri? Hannibal, Missouri, what's going on? What's going on? And I was trying to remember what I knew that I knew. And sure enough, I researched it a little bit and it's the home of Mark Twain. I was like, oh, Mark Twain, of course. Yes, riverboats and all the stories. And what we found here is that Dan Quarles was the inspiration for Mark Twain's gym in Huck Finn. In fact, he was the inspiration for multiple stories that Mark Twain wrote. Dan Quarles was owned by Mark Twain's favorite uncle. And this is what Mark Twain himself wrote about Dan. And this is from Mark Twain's autobiography. And he said, I'm just going to read it because it's really beautiful about what he's saying about this person. We had a faithful and affectionate good friend, ally and advisor in Uncle Daniel, a middle-aged slave whose head was the best one in the Negro Quarter, whose sympathies were wide and warm, whose heart was honest and simple and knew no guile. He has served me well these many, many years. I've not seen him for more than half a century. And yet spiritually, I've had his welcome company a good part of that time. And I have staged him in books under his own name and as Jim, and carted him all around to Hannibal, down the Mississippi on a raft, and even across the desert of Sahara in a balloon. And he has endured it all with the patience and friendliness and loyalty, which were his birthright. So Mark Twain, as a young man, had a friend in this man, Dan Quarles, and so much so, and so affected him so much that he wanted to preserve the memory of who he was in one of American literature's greatest, you know, protagonists of Jim. And I was elated. I don't know if any of you can imagine or, you know, finding this information out, but this was the like, oh my gosh, this is the story. This is it. And I found this out the day before that we had to present to NBC. I hadn't found anything that was like a hook yet, that anything was, you know, quite as great. And I found the story about Mark Twain connection. And then we had the fourth great grandfather as this, you know, would-be comedian. So excited to tell this. And we were getting ready to present it to NBC and our inner teams and everything else. But this is the kind of stuff that I had to really just pick out and pick out and pick out and prove connections here, make sure, is that really him? Finding other stories. There were some enslaved narratives that were related to Dan Quarles that helped prove this. There was previous research on a different side. So a lot of work went into proving this. So really great story, a lot of fun. And I was really excited to tell it.
And there is someone who has ties to Hannibal, Missouri in the chat room. So they are emphatically saying, I'm from Hannibal! !! So yes, there's a lot of resounding applause in the chat room about your unearthed story. I can't wait for them to get to like the next part of the presentation.
I know, it's going to be great. Let's take it. So Nicka, I'm going to throw it to you. She's going to talk about athlete number two.
All right. So here we are with athlete number two. And this one takes us to the Deep South all over again. This athlete was a football player at Grambling State University, the Grambling State University, where everybody is somebody. I hear that is the quote. His paternal line had ties to several counties in Georgia, including Carroll, Coweta, Harrelson, and Hurd. There were a lot of incredible discoveries on this side. In particular, I loved seeing his father being a player at Grambling. He was a second generation football player, just like athlete one was a second generation athlete. In this scenario, we had two generations of people playing football at the exact same school. Additionally, we also had a grand uncle who played at Alabama. So we got two D1 programs in one immediate family. And as a sports aficionado, I was loving the entire thing. We also had an obituary, a World War I draft card, a World War I transportation passenger list, a veteran's headstone application for a great-great-grandfather. You all see, like, we're talking about young people, college-age young people, who where the world is, you know, many people think that they can't find this stuff, or that they don't have any connections to some of these things that are tried and true in research. Here we are sharing with you, yes, they do, and yes, they have it. And so, yeah, there's comments around the band at Grambling, absolutely, because that's a part of the whole story of Grambling University. And in addition to all the stuff related to World War One, I also had an article that detailed the organization of that same great-great-grandfather's unit in World War One, and pictures of them in training camp. Like, you all know we love our farmers. We love to see our little farmers. We love farmer on the census in a general farm. But to be able to have photos of a Black unit training at a camp for World War One before they got deployed, that in itself was, my gosh, you just cannot get a better story. So let's go into some highlights of some of the documents. Here are a couple of those from Mr. George Glenn, who was from Heard County, Georgia. We have his World War One draft card. To the left, you see he's marking his signature with a mark. And then this is a document on the right, which is the transport list. I love, this is one of my favorite documents for World War One. I love to see where our veterans, especially our Black ones, got a chance to deploy, because with the Civil War, yes, they were going to different states and different areas, but this one got them off of the North American continent for them to see the world. And so I love when I can see that. And I love to find out who the next of kin is. And on this one, it's his dad named Samuel Glenn. And he was a part of Company D of the 514th Engineers, which was a colored unit, which was deployed to Brest, France in 1919. Now, mom's side was no slouch here either. Okay, we have to remember the moms here were bringing it in terms of the research. And we researched both sides because we want to try to find the best story. It doesn't matter if it's mom or if it's dad. We want to find the best stories. So for mom was hitting Louisiana. This was a match made in heaven for me, especially considering that it's along the Delta and in the Northeast parishes, which are like where my family's from. For mom, she had ties to Rapides, Natchitoches, and Grant. And of course, I would be remiss being a Louisiana researcher if I did not remind everyone that that is not Natchitoches, it's Natchitoches. I hope the ancestors are smiling greatly on me for helping people with that pronunciation. With mom's side, I loved finding photos of her in high school, and not only her just in high school with her photos, but like playing softball and being in the band herself and thinking about her connection back to Grambling. That part was even better, was to see her, you know, in the band representing, and the fact that they had a unique surname, Earthly. Which was so super unique. That was great. And then, you know, the fact that like the earliest folks in their family we could trace back to were starting in Louisiana as early as 1841. And so here we have two incredible athletes with getting back to second and third and fourth great grandparents for both of them, which was awesome. So for mom's side, we have an obituary. I love obituaries. It's another one of my favorite things. I feel it's totally underutilized. And this is for Arthur Earthly, senior, who was the athlete's great, great grandfather who died at 95 years old. That was the other thing. He had a bunch of folks on that, on his family, in his family that died old, and had these incredible obituaries where, you know, everything is laid out. And then also we had, a 1870 census, which we all, those of us that do African-American research, we know how important it is. For his ancestors, Samuel and Emmeline. There they are, our traditional farm laborer. We love that. We love to see people in agriculture. And again, great stories on both sides. But here's the thing. We've got to craft the arc. As much as we want to offer the cornucopia of stories, we don't have that much time. So I'm going to toss it back over to Lisa.
Okay. We only have about 15 minutes, so I'm going to go speedy. This is something that you can do when you're crafting your story to share with your family or whoever you're sharing it with. But these are the basic principles of creating that story. And it's knowing your audience is number one. What will resonate with that audience? Is your audience, yeah, are they young people? Is it an older group? Is it a group of genealogists? Is it a group of beginners? Or who are you sharing that story with? So what will resonate? Know your time limit. So how can you get the greatest impact in the amount of time you have? We often find stories that we want to tell, but we know that we can't tell them properly in the limited time frame that sometimes we have. So you need to choose your story and what you're going to be telling to get the greatest impact in the time limit that you have. And lastly, you need to know your hero. So you need to keep your focus on that main character. I think as genealogists, we get so excited. We want to include everything. We want to tell the stuff. And then everyone just gets lost. They're like the second great grandparents, aunt, cousin, second, twice removed, what? Like, it just gets all confused. So keep it to your hero. Know your hero, focus on the hero of the story, and keep that focus on that character. So how we did that with our piece for athlete one, knowing my audience. So my audience was this athlete, right? So I'd be sharing the story with this athlete that he would then share and give to the audience of whoever's watching this awesome segment. So, but I knew he was an athlete, but he was also creative. He was getting his master's in graphic design, and he was doing design for the athletic department of Michigan State. So I knew that something creative in his family tree would resonate with him. I knew my time limit. Both Nicka and I had the same amount of time limits, about 5 minutes. So that includes intros, explanations. There's a lot of B-roll of them doing all their football stuff and in the locker room and in the practice facility and all of that. So at the end of the day, it's going to be about a minute to a minute and a half of real family history storytelling. So that's a very small amount of time. So I had to get the greatest impact. And knowing my hero, I chose the characters in the story that were the guy that was in California and then his father, Dan Quarles, what I thought would be the big reveal and with the inspiration behind Jim of Huckleberry Finn and all of that. So I had my characters, I had my time limit, I had my audience. I was ready. Nicka. Take it away.
All right. For athlete number two, he was an engineer. Not only was he an engineer, but also was his father. And they both were connected to the same fraternity. And those were like the two hallmark things that I knew that I had to hit with him. Again, we are only getting a minute to a minute and a half worth of time. And some of you are like, are you serious? Go back and watch the majority of the stuff we do. It is very succinct. We only have really kind of one or two opportunities to really hit it and get the emotion and the reaction and stuff that we need to get. So we are strapped for time, just like we are now. We're trying to run through this to make sure we have enough time for your questions. And so the athlete's dad studied engineering, and their World War I ancestor was in an engineering battalion. So for me, it just felt like a natural fit to focus on the veteran. The other thing was with the photos and with all of the ephemera associated with it, it just made for a great visual story to be able to tell. Because one of the things that often happens when we're telling African-American stories is that we don't necessarily have the most visuals to show. And so for this one, because we had visuals, yes, we were leaning in, because then that way it could just, you know, teleport you in time. All right, so let's talk about our shoot plan, because you can't just show up and expect for everything to happen. That's not how this works. That's not how the magic of TV operates, everyone. I hope you understand that. So with that said, you have to be prepared, okay? Make sure you have your plan ready. That means that when you walk in there, you don't just come with the 1950 census printed out and you pass it across the table and you tell the people, look at your ancestors. No, you have to have a plan. You have to be able to connect, right? You got to know the story backwards and forwards, because especially in our scenario, the production company, the director, everyone's going to be looking to you to be the expert. And if you don't know backwards and forwards what's going on, everyone's going to be standing around looking like, well, wait a minute, I thought Nicka and Nisa, I thought they had the answer. She doesn't know? No, you got to know. You also have to know your goal. What's the most important thing, right, to you about sharing the story? Like, you got to decide. And sometimes you got to do that on the fly. Lisa's going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Knowing your story, you know where you can kind of move and be agile with stuff. The other thing is, play to whatever your strengths are. Are you funny? Are you a really sincere person? Are you clever? Whatever you do that works well, that's just a natural part of your personality, make sure that you really, really use that in your storytelling and use that to help captivate the people that you're speaking to, whether it's an athlete or whether it's your family. All right. So for both of us, this is always the tricky part with all of these that we do. That's why Lisa's making this face, because we're like, we plan, but sometimes your plans don't work out exactly how it is. Well, what do we mean? We typically have an hour planned for the interview. And even though you're only seeing a minute and a half, that was at least an hour of us sitting there with that person. And usually we ask more than 30 questions. In this instance, we asked more than 30. Even though the athletes had filled out a questionnaire and they were previously interviewed and even their parents were supposed to be involved with it, we had to involve all of that. We also had to get all that B-roll. Well, what's B-roll? It's when the person is not sitting there and it being interviewed. It's all the cutting to their highlights and maybe them tossing the ball up in the air, or they're in the stadium, or they're in their room. We had to have that plan. So even though that it was 30 minutes of plan B-roll, it took like 2 hours because the production team is, if they're in a candy shop, they want to get all of it rather than being like, oh, you know, we really should have got that shot. No. The other thing is we had to plan for shoots to be indoors and outdoors. And when it's outdoors, you're dealing with sound. Somebody decides to come and mow the lawn. You all saw my sound thing tonight. My son came in here in my Snuggie and had to tell me, okay? So you just have to roll with the punches. And that was what we were dealing with. Lisa.
Great. And so this is the during, right? We talked about the before. We're in the during. This is the shoot plan. So for my shoot in East Lansing, Michigan, it was beautiful fall. I was so excited. I'd never been to Michigan in the fall. And my friend Jen told me, you need to go drive around Michigan and look at all the beautiful trees. And they were gorgeous. So, but it was really cold and really rainy. So that was kind of a bummer. And also, we only had 4 to 5 hours to shoot with our athlete. They had a game the night before, which meant they didn't arrive back in Michigan until the morning of that Sunday morning. And it was just we've had a very, very finite amount of time. That said, the production team had 6 locations planned for us in only that 4-hour shoot. Now, that's too many places. That's far too many places. We've told them that. They were just really excited and really wanted, like Nicka said, they wanted all the candy in the candy shop. So they were just wanting to do all of these things. So we really had to keep that in mind, where we were getting our pieces and what locations they were at and how much time we have, because you have a finite amount of time with your athlete. Nicka.
All right. For mine, the weather was completely different. The weather put on a show for us. The colors were so vivid. It was warm. I mean, this was November, so I was not expecting for it to be this warm, but it was in the 80s and it was not humid. It was absolutely awesome. We had 8 hours to shoot with our talent, which means that all of our B-roll stuff that we got, I mean, we ended up having way more time, but I think also because Lisa went first, we were able to plan appropriately. So definitely consider like talking to some of your genealogy buddies that have done presentations or have shared family history before to learn their tips and tricks, because there may be some things that you can implement when you're presenting that they have learned from experience. So just like I leverage Lisa, you make sure you leverage your genealogy buddies to make sure that you have maximum impact. The shots went from everything to being in the locker room, to the actual stadium. They got to get practice footage, footage with the athlete, with their frat, members of the band. We even got to film with his sibling and his parents. I mean, there was a lot of different locations that were part of that shoot as well. So moving on to the during, let's talk about the on-screen reveal, because we are literally just talking about the places that we set up the camera. We haven't even talked about what happens during the on-screen reveal. So let the story flow. We could plan forever, but sometimes it just comes out naturally. Just make sure that you're deliberate and keep the focus on the climactic moment. Like whoever the hero is that you've determined, like maybe it's the farm laborer that, you know, went from renting a farm to owning a farm between censuses. Make sure that you keep it on that particular person, because we all can follow the tree, but the average person, as much as we love and care for them and give them a family group sheet or a pedigree chart, they cannot follow. So stick to a small number of people. Make sure to give the story time. Like, don't be afraid to let the person just process and for it to be silent. Sometimes we rush so much because we want to get it all out. No, give them time to process, because a lot of emotions are involved in this. This is personal. Sometimes these are the first times that people are hearing these names and these stories, and so they want to be able to digest it. Also, read the room. Is your audience invested? I know you all are, because I'm reading the chat. I can see you typing back to me, but pay attention. If something isn't landing, move on. Do something else. All right, Lisa, You're
Yeah,
up.
so this is our on-screen reveal. So athlete one, you guys, he was so sweet. He was very much an introvert. He was very nervous at first, but he was seriously interested in finding out more information. So he was nervous, but he warmed up quickly. I got to talking to him about his art and that got him excited. I've talked about his athleticism and his family and how much he loved them and just connected with them. And so we got him chatting and then he warmed up pretty quickly. Some of the reveal highlights, he loved talking about his major, like I said, talking about graphic design. He is really excited to talk to his dad on the phone and talk about the things he learned that we gave to him. And he also made amazing connections at the time about the story to himself. So he was making the connections, which is amazing. And that means he's listening, means he's absorbing it. Really, really great. And then he was pretty flexible with us because we, remember, it was only 4 hours with this guy and we had six locations. Nicka had six locations and 8 hours. So he was very, very kind and gave us another 45 minutes of his time. And he did vocalize those deep thoughts, which was really moving.
All right. For my athlete, I could not have asked for better. He was literally freezing the entire time we did his interview. I don't know how he managed to not seem like he was, you know, an icicle, but they had it extremely cold in that locker room. The thing I loved about his shoot was that his parents and his sister stayed the whole day. So they also got to be a part of the shoot. The other thing that I did not know before we did the reveal is that he actually had a really close relationship with the son of the World War I veteran that I selected. And you just can't hope for better. He was drawn directly to that part of his tree and he just started reciting these stories off. And I was like, oh my gosh, but he never knew the name of this great-great-grandfather until we presented it that day. He also knew the exact dates of World War I. I want to give his teachers in school a round of applause because I did not have to tell him when World War I took place. He knew exactly the dates. His mother's reaction, oh my gosh, she was just overwhelmed with being able to learn her family history. And the best part is that by the time we had finished rapping and I had presented the history, he literally sat down and recited everything to his parents. I was like, why am I even here? You go right on ahead, sweetheart. You can tell it all.
I love
all
that.
Right.
And yeah, this is the during again. So now we're going to talk about a real-time pivot. We mentioned before that sometimes it's just not landing. You have to read the room. And so with my particular, Nicka had all, you know, rainbows and puppies and beautiful skies and great weather. And I had storm clouds and a shy athlete who was interested, but just wasn't quite sure. So we had to work a little harder to get him to connect and all of that. But things don't always go as planned, right? And sometimes you have to call the audible, recognizing when what you had planned is not going to work and you've just got to find a different way about it. You've got to, you know, figure something out. Maybe you remember, that's why we want you to know the story backwards and forwards, because if you know it that well, you can call the audible. If you know that playbook, you can call that audible. So the next thing, if you know it, you'll do it, okay? So know that playbook, refocus the story when needed. And lastly, take the hit. Sometimes it's not what your audience wants to hear, and you need to accept that difference and move forward and not expect them to react the way you've planned. So just sometimes you just got to take the hit. So in this, in relation to what we did with my athlete, what wasn't working? Mark Twain did not resonate with him. It wasn't a focus in school for him. He just kind of been giving like wows or cool, or like he was processing it with just kind of one word responses. But the big reveal that we were losing our minds over, that NBC Sports lost their mind over, everyone was so excited. We're like, you guys, how often do you get a connection like this where you get words from Mark Twain about who your ancestor was and the amazing person he was? And that just was not hitting, you guys. My little genealogy heart was like crumbling. I was so sad. But in the moment, I can't let him know that. I've got to pivot and I've got to find what was working. And what was working was he connected immediately to Dan Quarles' son, his other great grandfather, and his humorous and creative side, which I knew that, but that was kind of the B story. It ended up being the A story. He was way more interested in that. It was more relative to the now. So we find this a lot with younger generations. They're really more interested in the closer generations in the family tree. When you're like, oh yeah, the seventh great grandfather, Sometimes they're just not interested in learning that. So he also felt extreme gratitude for his position and opportunity because of the sacrifice. So we really got a lot more content and a lot more connection when I was able to pivot. Okay, hard decisions. I think this is me.
Right. Yeah, this is
All
you.
Right.
Right.
So hard decisions. And because of that, you guys, the hard decisions, when you are telling that story, it's nothing personal. So I love this statement by Ed Catmull, who is one of the founders of Pixar Films. And this is about the brain trust, where they have fellow creatives that critique the presented story. And he says, you are not your story. Meaning, if you tell a story and it's not hitting the way you wanted it to, it's not a reflection of you as a genealogist or you as a storyteller. It just means that story is not working. We need to adjust. So don't take it personally. So just go ahead and fix it and move forward. Serve the story. Always make choices that best serve the overall story, not just your favorite bits. Sometimes you're like, oh, but I just love this little part, but it's going to maybe be a tangent. Don't worry about it. Focus on what serves the story. And also be open to new ideas. Sometimes people can help you influence the story and make it better. So maybe you aren't the one that always knows how to solve the problem. Listen to other things, new ideas. So the way that we did that with this particular instance, for me, for ours, it meant serving the story, meant choosing the best part, meant, you guys, we completely cut out the entire Jim or Dan Quarles portion. And that was my decision. I went in straight away. The production company was like, oh, we can make it work. And I said, absolutely not. This is not the star of the story. And it broke again. I broke my little genealogy heart to cut that part. But that was not the focus. That was not the purpose of this. The purpose was him being excited about his family and then wanting to share. So he learned it. He learned the story, but we cut it from the final cut. We recrafted with all that information because, you guys, when we craft a story, we have an arc and the beginning and ending. That was my main. I had to remove that main and reconstruct. And so it was a redraft, and that climactic moment was no longer in play. And lastly, there's no overtime, okay? When there's so much goodness to share, you guys, there is a finite amount of time. Just like today, we're running so late. We want to give you guys opportunity, but we're trying to choose the best pieces to suggest, to highlight. And we knew that was going to be difficult. So you just got to pick those pieces and make those hard decisions and go with it. And sometimes it's not going to be your favorites that get the spotlight, but that's okay.
All right. So now that we've talked about the interview, we got all the research done, we've presented it, we're going to talk about the group edit, which part is the after. Okay. And here's the thing about putting something together as a group. It's different than when you're working as an individual. Real-time feedback is going to definitely give you insight before you pitch it out. Because we have our own preconceived notions as to, okay, I think just like Lisa mentioned, there was a part that had to be cut. But there may be something that she sees in my cut that I don't see, and vice versa. So that real-time feedback is important. You need to make sure you talk with your peers to gain insight on improvements. One of the things that's like our big joke about this story is, at least when she finally got to Dan Quarles and Huckleberry Finn, she goes, Nicka, this is going to be great while we have this meeting. And I was like, Lisa, he's not going to know who he is. And she was like, are you sure?
He's a grad student. He has to know.
And I was like, he's not going to know. He's too young. And so Lisa, I was sitting there watching it. So I'm watching the interview happen. And I was like, I told her. And she Venmo'd me because she said, it was a bet. She Venmo'd me money because I was right. So again, talk to your peers and gain their insight. It can totally help you. Also, note the original reaction of your audience to understand the impact, right? Like that moment that they have that wow, or they sit back and you can see them processing, that's super important because that will tell you what is really truly resonating as opposed to you just kind of putting stuff out into the atmosphere. Now, with regard to our group edit, everybody was weighing in from Ancestry to NBC Sports and our production partners who are working. So that's three different groups of people. One of the best things that we did was we collated all the feedback into one document because it gets hellacious for somebody who's trying to edit something and they're getting 75 emails from like 25 different people. It doesn't make sense. So we just created one document. We got all the feedback in there. The other thing is you have to know your audience and the medium, right? This is something that was not going to be broadcast, like the longer form wasn't going to be broadcast on television. It was going to live online. And so the other thing is, with knowing what medium was that we're going to use the long piece, the thing is, the first edit, what we got, it felt like NBC Sports. Like, it was like, yeah, cut and dry, boom, 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 boom. Like, it was all of that. And like very little genealogy. So we were like, no, we got to add in like way more storytelling so that it grounds like the whole reason why we're here. And this was the first time we worked with this team, but we absolutely loved it. And I think they really latched on to all the learnings and the opportunities from Lisa's shoot to implement them in mine, which is why I got wonderful dogs and balloons and rainbows by the time it got to me. All right. So for the after, let's talk about the finished product that was put together. The thing that I loved about this was the parents and the family's positive reactions. They loved seeing their family history presented in this way, getting text messages from them and DMs. And like, I remember hearing about our athlete number one from Michigan State walking through his dorm after they had wrapped their session, giving pronouncements about who he was and who his ancestor was, you know, just gesticulating like wildly. And one of the comments that really resonated with me, especially in us posting the cut online, that someone said, really love this 5-minute segment. Hopefully Ancestry can continue to do more of these, especially for young Black Americans who might not know much about their history. It can be a real confidence booster just knowing who you descend from and the qualities and characteristics they had and displayed to make it in life. I thought that was a great way of wrapping up our pieces. And so yeah. If you are interested in watching them, because some people ask, I put the link in the chat, but if you want to see them, you can feel free to visit nbcsports.com/generations to view both Lisa's piece and my piece. Is there anything else you'd like to say before we get to questions?
Just thank you so much. We really loved working on this piece, and hopefully you guys can take these elements that we use every time we tell a story. We follow these steps and it helps us craft the story and hopefully bring those amazing magical pieces that we feel are magic to you as the audience. So thank you guys so much.
Well, thank you, Lisa and Nicka. What a fantastic presentation. And you know, your passion for storytelling comes across in your passion for teaching people how to tell stories. So that was wonderful. Thank you. We do have a few questions that have come in from the chat, and I'll read those in a moment, let you answer those. And then for those of you who would like to ask a question live, again, on your Zoom controls at the bottom is the raise your hand feature. If you click on that, I'll be able to see you and we'll be able to call on you for questions. So the first question comes from our good friend, Bernice Bennett, who also has Louisiana roots, Nicka, and your good friend. How did you all select these two athletes?
We pulled them out of the chocolate river.
No, that's a really good question. So this is something that Nicka and I have to deal with all the time. We do not get to pick people most of the time. We have a team at Ancestry as our brand media team, and they go and partner with different entities like NBC Sports or CNN or whoever, and they come up with the idea, and then usually they have casting in mind. In this particular, they had both of the athletes already pre-chosen. So that puts a lot of pressure on our team because we have to find a story whether we like it or not. There's no going back and being like, oh, you know what? There's just really nothing that's going to fill the time. We have to find something. So when I found something the day before that presentation, that was a big deal because we had to find it. So yeah, they're usually chosen for us.
Right. So next question we had, you mentioned hours and hours of footage and lots of B-roll. Did the production company or does Ancestry provide the entire interview and all the B-roll to the folks who were being interviewed, or do you just save it for future projects? What happens with all that content?
Well, you have rights and privileges to these things because different entities are involved. But the best part of what we do is the fact that we get to hand the trees and the research to the people who are a part of it. So that's the most important thing, is that they get access to that tree, they get access to the documents.
Great. Let's see. Lots of comments about how did you not scream when the person did not know who Mark Twain was? But
there was a lot of self-control. And I did hear Nika's voice in my brain going, I told you. No, right. So well, yeah, it was hard, but He knows now.
He's doing more research, I'm sure.
And he did tell his mom, and I knew his mom would know, because it's a different generation, I think. And his mom knew, and she was really excited about it. So he did share it with his parents.
Was mom Gen X or Boomer generation?
Yes, she's
yes,
Gen X.
Gen X.
Good for us. All right. Are there any questions from the audience that they would like to pose live to Lisa and Nicka?
I did see one other one from Bernice. Yep. She said, at one point, did you redirect the story? And I think I can answer for Lisa. We just filmed. We went with the shoot plan regardless. The thing is, you instead of editing on site, like during the interview, you don't do that. It's almost like what I call, like when you go on a research trip in the courthouse, you do a smash and grab, right? Like theoretically speaking, where you go, you get everything in your arms, you don't analyze on site, you wait until you get back to the hotel or until you get back home for you to do the analysis. And with shooting, it's the exact same way. You are going in to capture all of the elements. And then that gives you more freedom to be able to craft the story and edit it in the format that you need to. So the short answer is we redirected after it was filmed, as opposed to trying to do it while it was in the midst of happening.
There was a pivot in filming with how much time I spent on that portion of the story, because again, I was seeing it wasn't landing. It wasn't the reaction that I was hoping for, that I thought would really resonate, was not there. And you guys, we see this a lot. This is actually not unique. We think, oh, this is the part they're just going to love. They're going to totally love this. And then most times they cling on to some random thing. They're like, oh my gosh, I had no idea his eyes were blue. And you're like, okay, cool. Like they cling to something, and it doesn't necessarily mean it's the wrong thing. It's just, you've got to pivot and stop spending the time and going, no, 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 but we want you to know this part. So really let them help guide you. And that we did have to do that on site, but the choosing of the cutting, yeah, as Nicka said, was after.
Well, I'll take the final question then. So Ancestry produces lots of stories. You have access to content to develop stories from here to eternity. So what's your favorite stories to produce? Is it film? Is it written? Is it short form articles, long form storytelling? What are both each of your favorite ways to tell stories?
That's a very loaded question.
Because it's all
because it evolves. You know what I mean? Like as mediums evolve, you know, and just the means for which to tell the story. I mean, you know, at the heart of it all is family and community. And for me, I latch onto like those timeless stories, regardless. You know, some of my more recent stuff that I've worked on has been written. It hasn't been on television, where, you know, again, it's lasting in that way. But then, you know, then there's this one that I absolutely love. It's one of the most favorite things that I've done. And really just because of my own family's connection to Grambling, and me feeling like in some ways that was my way of giving back to Grambling what it had given to my family. So I'm going to pick all of them. All of the above.
For me, I will say my background is in theater, and storytelling is my original background, my career prior to Ancestry. And I love when people can go to places where their ancestors were, the walking in the footsteps of their ancestors, or holding the letter that they signed, or something that connects directly to that ancestor, not just a story. Censuses are great too, but when you can walk in the places where your ancestors have walked, I just think there's something really special about that, and really humbling and beautiful. So those are my favorite stories.
Fantastic. Well, again, thank you both so much. And thank you to Ancestry for sponsoring tonight's webinar. We greatly appreciate it, and we look forward to more stories from Ancestry, and we look forward to whatever is produced next. So I will just share my screen for a moment and share with everyone a few things coming up from the National Genealogical Society, including tomorrow night. I will be back on Zoom with Terry Koch-Bostick, Matt Berry, LaJoy Mosby, and Judy Nimer-Munn to provide a preview of the NGS 2024 Virtual Family History Conference. So if you're not already pre-registered for that event, Kate is dropping into the chat that link down there at the bottom, or you can scan that QR code here if you're really quick. But in appreciation for your attendance tonight, we do have a code for $25 off the conference registration for those of you who are here tonight. That code is 2024VFHC when you go to register for the 2024 NGS Virtual Family History Conference, sponsored in part by Ancestry. We have coming up in May, on the 22nd of May, our next Culture Conversations event with Megan Smolniak, who will be talking about the White House, Ellis Island immigrants, and Hollywood. Many of you know Megan, and we are so looking forward to having a Culture Conversation with her to hear more about her experiences from doing the genealogy for Prince or the Obamas or politicians and athletes of all kinds, and her work in genealogy for decades, telling stories about our ancestors. On a week later, on the 29th of May, our board member Lisa Fanning will be hosting a Member Connects event, taking your genealogy research skills beyond family history, with Allison Wild, Tristan Tolman, Bonnie Holly, Tynan Peterson, and Rhonda Kevorkian, talking about taking the research skills they've developed as genealogists and applying those outside of the family history community. I should also mention the GRIP Genealogy Institute is coming up in June and July. If you are not registered yet for a virtual event in June or an in-person event at La Roche University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, we encourage you to go to grip.ngsgenealogy.org and choose your course and register. And then finally, for those of you who are over 65 and have a Medicare Advantage plan, did you know your NGS dues can be reimbursed by Grouper? If you go to groupergroups.com/NGS, find out if your Medicare Advantage or Medicare Supplement plan is eligible, and you can have your dues reimbursed up to the full amount of $85. This is a program very similar to Silver Sneakers that you may have heard of, which provides reimbursement for your health club memberships. Grouper provides reimbursement for your membership in the National Genealogical Society. So with that, let me thank you all for joining us tonight, and we will have the recording up soon. We appreciate your time. Nicka, Lisa, thank you both again, and we appreciate everything you and Ancestry do for the genealogy community. Good night, everybody.